young men or young women's first sexual experience. And the elders have responsibility in all of those things. So it has significant impact on the whole psychology of a person. You know, instead of living out in the street or, you know. Or, well, I mean, in France, there's a tradition that a young man will have an older woman initiate them to live in a certain way. But there's a lot more. But there's a bit amount of effect that's come from direct and indirect, more indirect contact with the people of the civilized world outside. I understand that Kogi used to get married when they were like 30. And now they're often married when like 14, 15. And part of it is because their contact with our sarios, or we was, who are another, there were basically four nations living in the Sierra. They're different, but they're very similar in many ways. The Kogis were most intact because they were able to move themselves out of the way most. And so the Wiwas, who live further down by the coast and therefore have contact with the people, the kind of mestizo people, colonist type people who really have done a lot of damage very quickly to the environment. So they became affected, you know, in these kinds of things like also relationships and so on. And somehow that got, you know, so they started marrying their children off much younger. You know, and the companion in life is, I mean, there's a very, you could say they're roles, but they're not, they're all closed roles. I mean, the husband helps the wife a lot. And it's, you know, it's all family kind of stuff. I mean, everybody else. So America is really a very different thing because of all the different cultures that are coming here. So it would be interesting for you, because so many of people came work just with me for the gaudy external part of it. I mean, it really struck me when I came this time. And I was at my mother's house. I didn't go out very much for a long time. Then I went to San Diego. And so I was in the airport waiting for a person to come and get me. And so this Indian family comes, and these Mexicans come, and these blacks come, and there was a few other, and it was just like, you know, all these ethnicities. And a lot of people have just come to this country. And I mean, I'm a little sad when they're just like blending into it. So, in the video that was made by Alan Herrera, the message from the heart of the world, I mean, that was really the first contact that Kogi wanted to say that the earth is in problem. And they understand very seriously that it's their job to maintain harmony on the planet. And so, okay, I was talking about sacred places. So part of the taking care of the earth, beyond ecology, is understanding. And you could say there's a science, and it has to do with time and space, which is what this wolf and warp that we live in is based on, which you could say is the fabric of Maya. But it's the place that we get to practice. These places, which are vital places or sacred places, there are energies that are there. It's very easy if you go into very high mountains. For me, that's a place where the cosmic energy touches the earth. And if you go here in South America, it's very easy to understand why people even refer to the mountains that surround them as Lord, Papa. You know? And when the Christians came, they had to put Christian clothes on these things. And if the people would do that, then they let them keep going to their sacred places and doing their things. But they put a statue of Jesus up there, and the grottos, and the lakes, and the feminine places, they put a virgin. You know, but people would still go to these places to connect with the energies that are there. You know, and so, when the places are respected, and they have a certain, a special pristine kind of energy, because of where they are, and if they're not damaged by people going and doing other things there, you know, so that force is nourished, and also there's like a pact that happens, and so that it helps the people. And because because agriculture is the basis of most people's lives. You know, it's also related to doing things in harmony with the season and the agriculture cycles. And so that's why the point is that the rain comes when it should come, and the sun comes when it should come, and everything grows well, and everything flourishes in a good way. And for a long time now, for many years, long before I went to South America, whenever I go somewhere, the farmer will open things for change, and it's not nothing to be in. And it has continued. When I was now with the Kogis, they left me alone for a few days with the women, because they went down to the biggest town in that kind of area this year to build the women's ceremonial house. And it rained for 4 days, and it's a time that it shouldn't be raining at all. So Ramoncito, who's the eldest son of Ramon, who was in that video, this is Wiwa territory, but there's a lot of Kogi who live next to me. So he was he's the main mama there, and his job is to divine about when things are going on, why. You know, a lot of what is involved in divination is knowing how to ask questions. You know, it's not necessarily somebody comes and you have a vision and somebody tells you this is a story, although that happens also. But it's also when one is inquiring, you know, what's going on, and then there are ways of checking. You know, some of it is using tools that basically externalize our own intuition. But as I say, it's not like a rationally organized system, like a Western organized system. It's something which is much more natural. It's a wild. And something which has always appealed to me. I mean, it feels right to me. I feel a little stiff inside different kinds of esoteric schools where the whole thing is more organized. So he said, this is a bad rain. This is going to damage the yucca, which is one of the most important crops, staple crops there. And the reason that this is happening is because the families are not united. The husband and wife are arguing with each other. They don't have patience to hear each other and to listen to each other and to agree and to come to become one mind, one heart. And the children see that, and that affects them. And then it starts to affect everything. And if we go on like this, in 4 years, you're not going to get any food. So this was spoken in front of the whole community, and people had come from different directions. And what was planned, because I was leaving around that time, was that they were going to the community further up and the one further down, and they were going to speak in the ceremony houses about this. And if people were in agreement, the following weekend, I mean, they have gotten that far to know what days are. They're all going to get back together in this place, and they're going to spend 4 days fasting and doing internal work to try and to try and bring all this back. So I mean, this is going a lot further, a lot more in detail, but it's really taking responsibility. We are the ones who create, you know, the weather and everything else like that. It's not like the idea of some guy with magic power doing it. It's like the quality of our thoughts is creating an environment. So there are a lot of people, I think that, you know, in the Bible it talks about Sodom and Gomorrah, and God says, if you find me 100 just men, that will destroy this place. And Abraham finds 100 and said, well, how about 70, 50, 10, 1? Then you better get out of town because it's going to take these people out. And what was it? It was volcanoes and earthquakes. That's what, according to the Bible, that's what was happening. So the Mayan prophecies about, you know, what things are happening. I don't know what it means. I don't know timing specifically, but things seem to be moving in a way that's in agreement with what the prophecies are talking about. And the Mayans don't know what the result and the result is going to be. They say it's not necessarily been determined. We have a choice in how we act. And what the Mamos are saying is that we have to keep things together because where we live is the heart of the world. And it's interesting, if you look at a map of the Americas, it's the only part of the world where the whole, from north to south, is in one continuum, without, you know, the land block. And North America is the head, and Mexico and Central America is like the neck. You know, and then Colombia gets up around the heart. Ecuador is more like, you know, the center. The word Cusco in Quechua means belly button. And Patagonia, Pata in Spanish means the foot, the leg. So it's kind of a curious thing like that. But they say that where they live is the heart of the world, and this, and there are a great quantity of vital places there which they are responsible for paying, for making offerings, to maintain the harmony of all the details of life on Earth, including things that haven't been invented yet. And many things have been out of their hands for a long time because of the conquest. And there are things that are being done by, or planned to be done by government, which would be very destructive to some of those sacred places. And really what the people in the Sierra, the main thing that they are doing with their focus is recovering lands so that they can take care of them, because that's the only way they can do their job of taking care of the planet. And the most direct, straightforward, and easy way to do that nowadays is buy it. And they don't have any money there, so, you know, so there's been started, the Arawakos are the ones who really started. The Arawakos were being run by the Franciscans for about 8 years. And they've generally been considered by all the other peoples in the Sierra to be the responsible for communicating with the Bunachi, or the younger brother. So the Kogi coming out, which has started happening in the past very few years, is something really major. It's considered really major by the rest of them. And it's because that they are really concerned. I mean, he tried to make that point in the video that was made in 1991, and the book, which was also written in that same time, but which I just seen now. And now there are more and more that come, there are things that are coming out, and Barry and I were looking last on the internet, and there's a number of other things that are happening. So it's not like I'm going to go to Santiago and say, I mean, the mama who I was with last year, well, the last few couple of years I've been here, the two most profound people I've met in South America in these past years were both Kogi mamas. The first one, at the time I met him, was probably about 90, between 95 and 98. And I was living with a mama who was like 76, and his father-in-law was about the same age, we guessed. And we went up to visit him, and one day he said, "Today we're going to visit the father-in-law of my father-in-law." So we went up and up and up. We came into this men's ceremonial house, is what we'll call it. And there was this man with white hair, which you don't see very much there. I mean, these old people don't have black hair. He's there lying in a hammock. And we walked in, he looked, and he walked out. So we shared the coca with other people and sat down. And he came back and sat down in his hammock, and all of a sudden, it was like being with the master when he comes before Sasa and sits in silence for a while. I mean, it was like, but this lasted almost an hour. And at some point in the middle of this seat that I was in, there was a few things that came through, like things that had been said to me. My first vision quest, the medicine man came up, kind of sniffed around, and he said, "It's really quiet here." He looked me right in the eye and he said, "In fact, it's restful." He said, "I never met anybody before you who comes to our ways and really knows what the essence really is." And he said, "Little by little, you're going to meet most of the important medicine people who are alive nowadays." I didn't have an idea that it meant that I was going to leave the United States. And there are other things that came, some things that Sanchi had said to me. And I found myself in the space that happens in these incredible situations, like I feel like nothing in the middle of this incredible ocean, and said, "Well, here I am, I want help for something." So at a certain point we kind of came back, and Mama Santos looked at me, came in, like, you know, there's a lot of things that are, you know, communicated without words, normally. And we left. And we never even, but we, on the way down the mountain, he says, that was the music. That was the music. That doesn't happen with everybody. So I understood something important that happened, and this is the kind of things that, you know, I still understand. And I think we're all part of this whole thing. You know, there's something that's trying to take place. Sometimes I can say certain words, but I don't really know what I'm talking about. You know, like the earth itself is passing through initiation. And all the creatures, especially the human beings who represent the very thoughts of the earth, have to come along with her. That the Europeans, one part of the world that was the most sick before, and they came out looking to heal themselves because the whole culture is based on fear. You know, back from the Dark Ages, and that's why they developed the technology with so much emphasis on weapons. Because what do you need weapons for if you don't have fear? You know, and it's in the medicine. The philosophy is in the medicine that the disease is caused by an enemy, and they use antibiotics against life to kill the enemy. You know, whereas in Chinese medicine and Ayurvedic medicine and traditional medicine, indigenous medicine, instead of the universe being understood as this place where human beings are in danger, that and God's looking down with a stick to beat anybody who's sinning, and then later Jesus came along, but the devil came with the most. You know, the vision of the indigenous people and other spiritual traditions was that the universe is a mysterious place. Where there are antagonistic but opposite and complementary forces that are playing. And that life and health is about learning how to have balance between these things, which isn't something static, it's something that's always moving. You know, so it comes into all the different aspects of way of thinking. And there's a point in which